Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Now it's good to see you here in God's house today. We appreciate your presence. We have visitors. We're glad to have you. Of course, we're glad to have our own members. And it's good to be back home again after a wonderful tour of Jordan and Jerusalem and Athens, Greece. We had a good tour. We praise God for it. And we appreciate you that prayed for us while we were on the tour. We appreciate Brother Hobbs speaking for us last Sunday and then Wednesday nights a week ago, and then Brother John Bruce speaking last Wednesday night. We appreciate this, and we appreciate you that prayed for us, and God did give us a wonderful trip, and we thank God for it. It's always good to be back in the house of the Lord, and good to see you here. And you out in the radio listening audience, if you'll call a friend, have them to tune in and get the Northside Baptist Church Hour. You'll be doing them a favor. And us as well. Now, as most of you know in the radio listening audience, I'm sure, this is Preacher Edwin speaking from the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Take your Bible today and turn to the book of Acts chapter 17. I'm reading from page 1173 in the original Schofield Reference Bible. We just recently returned from our annual tour of the Holy Land. We went to Jordan, Israel, and then to Athens, Greece. And I saw some things in Athens, Greece that really stirred my heart. I went to the place where Paul preached his famous Mars Hill sermon. And I'm going to bring a message today pertaining to the scripture where Paul preached his famous Mars Hill sermon. And want to find out, is Paul's Mars Hill sermon needed today? Now we find in the book of Acts chapter 17 how that Paul, of course, was driven from Thessalonica unto Berea, and then he was persecuted there and went from Berea to Athens, Greece, and waiting there in Athens for Timothy and Silas to come to him. And if you read these verses, Acts chapter 17, you'll see what I'm speaking of. But I want to begin reading today with verse 22. Now in verse 22, the Bible said, "Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you're too superstitious. But as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, To the unknown God, whom therefore you ignorantly worshipped him, declare unto you. God that made the world, all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands. Neither is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things. And hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if happily they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone or graven by art and man's device. And the time of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given him assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, We will hear thee again of this matter. So Paul departed from among them. Howbeit certain men clave unto him and believe, among which were Dionysus and the Areopagite and a woman named Damaris and others with them. Now that's reading from Acts chapter 17, verses 22 through the remainder of the chapter. Just a few days ago, I stood there on Mars Hill while Paul preached this famous sermon. I stood there looking over the beautiful city of Greece, Athens, Greece. And there, my mind went back to the time when Paul stood there on Mars Hill and preached the word of God. Now, Paul had been brought from Berea, and was waiting here at Athens for Silas and Timotheus. Now we do know that Athens was a place of much learning. There's the Acropolis there, and there's the Parthenon there, the Parthenon, where, of course, the Greek goddess Athena, at one time, where they worshiped her, the Greek goddess there in Athens, which was the goddess of wisdom. And we stood there and heard our guide tell us about these things. And there at the Parthenon, and there, of course, on the Acropolis. And then we went down to Mars Hill, just a few yards away from, of course, the Parthenon. And there we heard the guide, of course, that it instructs us about this, tell us about the beautiful scene in which we did see. And it was a great joy to have been in Athens, Greece, on our last tour. Now, of course, back in those days, we find there were many men. There was, of course, Pericles, Socrates, Aristotle, and Plato, philosophers, and this statesman Pericles, and many others there in the area. And, of course, they were giving themselves over to much learning. They sought after wisdom. They wanted to learn new things. And, of course, they believed very strongly in that. And when Paul entered into the city of Athens and went to Mars Hill, he was confronted with this kind of wisdom. People want to learn something new all the time. And when Paul came on the scene, they said, "We want to find out what this babbler has to say." At any time a new speaker came on the scene, they were very anxious to learn about what he knew, what he had to say. And of course, if it didn't correspond with what they had to say or what they believed, there was a great opposition, to be sure. Now, you can imagine how they felt when the Apostle Paul, that little Jew, stood there, and much of his preaching cut cross-grain with their belief there in Athens, Greece, a place of learning in those days. Now, Paul stood up on Mars Hill. There's a beautiful solid rock there on Mars Hill where Paul stood. We went up on this solid rock, and there from the rock, you could see the beautiful, beautiful city of Athens, Greece, of which the classic city of Athens, Georgia, here is named after. And so as we stood there, our mind went back almost 2,000 years ago at that particular time. And today I want to bring the message on this line of thought. Is Paul's Mars Hill sermon still needed today? I believe it is. It's needed today just like it was needed in those days. There are several things I want to mention about this line of thought. Number one, I want us to notice the condition in that day and compare that with the condition of this hour in which we live. Look at verse 22 of my text. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, "Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious." Now, of course, they didn't like that. Now, you can be too superstitious. Just the other day, since I came back from my tour, my wife and I went to the post office and I received a letter. And we opened the letter, and that letter was from someone that said, "You must pass this letter on to someone else. If you'll do so, then you'll be blessed. You'll receive a certain amount of money or maybe gifts." Someone telling you, if you will mail out a copy to someone else, that you will be blessed, that you will receive money and benefits in many ways. And if you don't do it, then there'll be a curse on you, or there'll be someone to die in your family, or you may die, or a terrible tragedy may come to your home. When you get a letter like that, throw the thing in the garbage can, tear it up, and forget about it. Now, that's not of God. That's satanic. Now, that's stupid to mail out letters like that. That's superstition. And you'd be surprised today to know of people that are superstitious until it interferes with them serving God. Now, you can be absolutely too superstitious. You have a lot of people today, if a black cat crosses the road, they won't continue on. They'll turn around and go back. Or they'll make a mark on the windshield of the car. You have people today that would not walk underneath a ladder overhead, and all kind of superstition in the land today. And that can interfere with you serving God. Forget about these things that makes you superstitious. Many times it's of Satan, of the flesh, and not of God. I remember back when the Weinkauf Hotel burned in Atlanta. The Weinkauf Hotel was built in 1913. Now notice the number 13. It had 13 letters in its name. It had 13 parlor suits and 39 rooms, which are 313s, 39 rooms with showers. And they said because it had the number 13 connected with it in so many ways, that's why it burned. I don't believe a word of that. You don't have to be superstitious about that number 13. We're living in, by the grace of God Almighty, day by day. Whether it be number 13, 15, or 40, it doesn't matter. Whether you go on the ladder, around the ladder, that doesn't matter. Whether a cat crossed the road in front of you, behind you, that doesn't matter. Forget about all this superstition. I remember back in the days when I was a young boy, if a rooster crowed at a certain time of the night, and everybody got upset because they said there'd be a death in the family because that rooster crowed. Well, you can be too superstitious. Sometimes it will happen. It would have happened anyway had the rooster crowed or not. And so don't let superstition hinder you in the work of God. Don't let it put you to extra trouble. Don't believe too strongly in it because it can affect you. And Paul said, you people here in Athens, you're too superstitious. They were very superstitious people. They're very religious and cultured, but they were lost. Now you can be religious, you can be superstitious, you can be cultured and still be lost. You have multitudes like that today. So we notice, first of all, the condition. Number two, I want us to notice the command in verse 30. Is Paul's Mars Hill sermon good for us today? He said, ye men of Athens. He was talking about the people in Athens, Greece, and he could be speaking our hearts today as well. Ye men of Athens. He said, you hear what I have to say. You're too superstitious. In verse 30, notice his command. And the time of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. Now Paul is saying to these people here at Corinth, there was a time before Jesus came when God kind of looked over certain things, waiting for the coming of his dear son, but not anymore. He said, God commands men everywhere to repent. You're too superstitious. God is not going to wink at your sins. God is not going to look over your sins. God is not going to turn his back upon your sins. He said, God commands men everywhere now to repent since the Savior has come. Now notice he said, God passed over till Jesus came certain things. In Romans chapter 3 and verse 25, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are passed through forbearance of God. Now God's forbearance in Old Testament days, there God would bear with the people because he looked forward to that time when that sin debt would be paid. And God dealt in foreshadows and types and looked over the people as they made their blood sacrifices to the time when Jesus would come and pay that sin debt and fulfill literally and minutely every Old Testament prophecy in the Old Testament when he was upon the earth and when he died and rose again. And Paul said, now you people here in Athens, you need to wake up and realize that now God requires you repent. Now Jesus said, except you repent, you'll all perish. God requires repentance from everyone today. Repentance and believing on Christ go hand in hand, like a glove on your hand. You cannot separate the two. They go together. Now there's a big argument today about whether or not repentance is needed in this hour in which we live. But it is needed. You can't separate repentance and believing on Christ. They go together. And you must realize that. And so he said, now God commands men everywhere to repent. Then that moves us to thought number three, and that is the day of judgment. Look in verse 31. Because he hath appointed a day in which he would judge the world in righteousness. Now Paul is telling these people here at Athens, Greece, he said there's coming a time, there's coming a day when God will judge the world in righteousness. He said that time is coming. You need to get ready for the judgment. Someone talking to man one time about his soul, he said, man, you need to get saved. Aren't you afraid to die? He said, no, I'm not afraid to die. He said, well, you know, it's appointed a man once to die and after that the judgment. Have you thought about the judgment? He said, no, I hadn't thought about the judgment. He said, you better do some thinking then about the judgment. If when a man died, that was the end of him, well, then he could say, I'm not afraid to die. But what men don't know and realize today is that it's not the end. People that commit suicide today, as a general rule, they think, well, I'm ending everything, and that'll be the end. I'll never know anything else. What they don't know is that when they commit suicide, they drop into hell, and then they're brought out in the judgment. They don't realize that's coming a judgment. Now, you need to realize that. The Bible says a judgment is coming. God's appointed a day in which he's going to judge the world in righteousness. First of all, he's going to judge the just, that is to save people. At the end of this age, at the rapture, when God takes away his people to meet him in the air and carry them back to the judgment seat of Christ, all of God's children, from the beginning of the church age unto that present moment, will stand before God to be judged. All the great saints of God in years gone by who's gone on to be with the Lord will stand at the judgment seat of Christ in that day. Now God will judge his people. Remember, your record had its beginning the moment you were saved. God is not going to judge any saved person for sins that were committed before you were saved. The moment you were saved, every sin you ever committed from the time you came into this world until God saved your soul, God blotted out. You may say, now preach, Edwards, I committed a lot of sins before God saved me. God doesn't know about that now. He forgot about it. He cast it from his back. He won't bring that up against you anymore. That's gone forever. Don't let the devil worry you about sins you committed before you got saved as far as the judgment is concerned. You might have mistreated a lot of people, done a lot of wrong, and you may worry about that, and you may suffer affliction in your body because of your sins before you got saved. But that has nothing to do with the judgment. God will judge his people for the things they have done in their body from the time they were saved until the time they die or until the rapture. That'll be a judgment of the just, that is the justified. And then he said that's coming a time for the judgment of the unjust. Now the unjust is the unjustified. And that has to do with that sinner. Every lost sinner that dies without God at the end of the great millennium, which is yet in the future, will come out of the grave. God will bring him out. He'll stand before God at the great white throne and he'll be judged. And he'll be judged for all the sins he's committed from the time he was born into the world until he died. Every one of them. Somebody said, well, I'm going to hell anyway, so I might as well go out here and have a good time, eat, drink, and be merry, rob, steal, kill, and whatnot. I'm going to hell anyhow. But what they don't realize is that God's keeping a record of those sins. And there is a degree of punishment. And you're going to be punished according to the sins you committed. That has nothing to do with the time element. That has to do with the degree of your punishment, which is taught in the Bible. And every sinner will stand before God that dies lost. And every sin he's committed from the time he was born unto the time he dies will face God at the great white throne. And your record will be there. And God will mete out your degree of punishment according to your record. And then you'll be cast into the lake of fire according to the Bible. That judgment is coming. And Paul stood there in Athens, Greece on Mars Hill and told those people that's coming a judgment for the just and also the unjust. Then number four, let's look at the judge, verse 31. Because he's upon the day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he has ordained. Now when you have a judgment, you have to have a judge. When you have a court trial, you have a judge. Now that's coming a time when people will be judged at the judgment seat of Christ or at the great white throne judgment, and that judge will be that man whom he hath ordained. Now who did God ordain? He's speaking here about his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He has been ordained of God. He will be the judge. When you stand yonder at the bema seat of Christ, there sitting on the throne will be none other than Jesus Christ. He'll be the judge that you will face there in the judgment. And he'll be a judge. He'll be a stern judge. He'll even look like a judge in that day. He'll be a judge. Many years ago, I was sitting in the courtroom here in Athens. And there sat a little weaselly judge up there on the bench about half asleep. And there's an old farmer sitting in front of me. And I overheard his conversation when he said to another farmer, he said, you know, if I had a mule that didn't look any more like a mule than that man does a judge, I'd never start a crop. Now, there's some people just don't look like a judge, but Jesus Christ will look like a judge in that day, and he will be a judge. No doubt about that. Today he's the Savior, then he'll be the judge. And he'll be judging people in that day. Jesus will be the judge. And of course he'll know all things. It'll be a righteous judgment. There's a man one day walking down the, riding down the street, and someone scared his team of horses and they started running away, and there was a strong gentleman walking up the street, and immediately knowing how to handle horses, he darted out and grabbed the horse by the bridle and stopped him and saved the man's life. And the man thanked him and he went on his way. Some few weeks later, this man that was in the runaway carriage committed a crime. He was brought into the courtroom. And lo and behold, the man sitting on the judge's bench is none other than the man that had saved his life. It was the judge. And the judge meted him out a severe sentence. And the young man stood up and said, "Your Honor, sir, that's a strong sentence." Said, "You remember, now I remember you well the other day, how that you saved my life. And now you're meting out to me a very stern and strong sentence." You know what the judge said? He said, "Young man, that day I was your Savior. I saved your life. But," he said, "it's different now. I'm your judge." Now Jesus Christ will be your Savior today, but he'll be your judge in the future. He'll be the one that'll do the judging. He'll judge in righteousness. I'm sorry to say, and you know as well as I, and I can't comment on this too much, and no need of you trying to think maybe I shouldn't comment on it, because we must cry aloud and spare not. In many of our courts today, we don't have a justice. We have a rotten federal appeals courts today that's turning loose criminals, getting men off a death row. And there's ACLU in America, America's cranky lunatic union, is doing all they can to get people off the death row and to get criminals out of prison, out of jail. And the land today is being filled with criminals because of these compromising, liberal, evil, ungodly federal appeal court judges, other judges that don't have backbone to sell out to the criminals that let these men go free. And the innocent people, law-abiding citizens on this nation, are the ones having to suffer, having to pay the price, having to clothe and feed these men that should have been put to death. Now, since I've been in the Holy Land, somebody said to me, said, "Preach Edwards, they'll executed, put to death two men in different states since you've been gone." I said, "Well, thank God. I'm glad two more states had backbone enough to do what God said in the book, even though don't many states do it and have the backbone to do it. Our judicial system so rotten until it's pathetic, it stinks to high heaven. And every time a man commits cold-blooded murder and he's put to death, that's exactly what God said do to him. That is his punishment, and that helps to deter crime in this nation. I know the liberals, the infidels, and the atheists don't believe that, but it's true whether they believe it or not. It deters crime, and you better believe it. Now that's a judge. Number five is the method. Verse 31. He will judge the world in righteousness. No righteousness in most of our courts today. Now don't misunderstand me. We have some good judges in the land. We have some honest judges in the land. We have some Christian judges in the land. And they will judge according to what they think is right. And they'll try to treat people right. But you have the land filled with crooked judges and crooked lawyers. And they'll do anything for money. And the criminal is their buddy. That's why they make the money. And they don't want to do away with too many criminals, because the more crime they commit, then of course greater will be the filling of their coffers, and the more jobs they'll have, there'll be more demands for judges and lawyers. And they like that. That's their livelihood. They're for that. You can understand that. And so the method is going to be Jesus will judge the world in righteousness. Now when he judges, whatever he does will be right. It'll be right. Whatever he does will be right. It might not be right in many courts today. Like the dear old colored lady and her husband went into the courtroom, and they had been fussing about their children, and there they faced the judge who had 10 children. And the judge gave all 10 of those children to the husband. And as the lady went out the courtroom, she was heard saying this. She said, "Ain't no more justice in this world no more." She said, that judge done give all 10 of my young'uns to that husband of mine. He ain't a daddy, neither one of them. Said, "Ain't no justice no more." Well, you face those things today in the land, and a lot of injustice and non-justice in the land today. But we need to realize that when we face God in the judgment, there will be justice according to the Bible. And so he judged the world in righteousness. Number six, he then in verse 31, we have the resurrection assured here. In verse 31, he hath given assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. Here we find the Apostle Paul telling the people that Jesus was raised from the dead. He came from the grave. Now he knows he had seen the empty tomb. That's the empty tomb. He was seen in person, and that was the coming of the Holy Spirit. Now we visited that tomb in the Holy Land tour we just made. Went back in the tomb once again and once again. I saw the place where our dear Lord lay. There in Joseph Arimathea's tomb, a rich man's tomb, and the beautiful garden there between Mount Calvary and the garden tomb. Or rather, the gardens between the Calvary and the tomb. And it was that's a beautiful place, but that was an empty tomb. Several of the people said that went into the empty tomb, said, "Thank God it's empty. Thank God he's not there. Thank God Jesus came out of that tomb." And he did. That is the empty tomb to verify the fact that Jesus came out of that tomb. And then he was seen in person. For 40 days and 40 nights, the Son of God was seen upon the earth. 40 days and 40 nights, he went among the people. He ministered. He ate with them and instructed them. And then he said, now in 10 days, or rather you go back and tarry till the Holy Spirit comes. And 10 days after the Jesus' ascension back to heaven, then the Holy Spirit came. We visited the upper room, get on this tour as we do every year, while the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost. And Jesus ascended back to heaven. We visited the rock from which Jesus ascended back to heaven again this year, as we did every year we've gone. And Jesus went back to heaven 10 days later. The Holy Ghost came. Proven without a shadow of a doubt, the resurrection was a fact that Jesus did come out of the grave and went back to heaven, now at the right hand of God. Paul was telling these people about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and that's something the devil really hates, is the doctrine of the resurrection. Then we come to thought number seven. There's the results, verses 32 through 34. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, others said, "We will hear thee again of this matter." Howbeit certain men clave unto him and believed. Now the Bible said when they heard of the resurrection from the dead, or of the dead. Beloved, if you want to really stir the devil up back in the days of the Apostle Paul, and in the days of the apostles on the earth, you just talk about the resurrection. Preach on the resurrection. Tell people that Jesus came out of the grave. And you really stir up a hornet's nest. They hated that doctrine. The Bible says some mocked. And some put it off. Said, "No, we won't get saved. They like Felix." But some believed. And they were saved. Paul stood there on Mars' hill. He said, "Oh, you men of Athens, you're too superstitious. Here you are marred in superstition and philosophy and so forth. And you know nothing about the real Savior, the true God, real true life." That little old Jew stood there and preached the word of God on the anointing power of the Holy Ghost. And those men trembled in their boots. They said, "Let's hear what this babbler's got to say. He's going to say a speech. Let's hear him, see if he's got a thing to say." And brother, did he say? He said a mouthful. He jawed their eye teeth. He shook them in their boots. He made them tremble as he preached the gospel of Jesus Christ and told about the Savior, the death, burial, and resurrection of our dear Lord. Yes, it's a fact. I'm glad that he came and paid that sin debt. Is Paul's Mars Hill sermon good for Athens, Georgia today, like it was for Athens, Greece in those days? Absolutely so. It's good for us today, and we do well to heed this message. There's a boy one time that ended up in serious trouble. He was the only son of this mother, and she was brokenhearted. He was sentenced to die. She wept and she prayed. She wanted to see her boy free, or see him at least his life be spared. And she did everything she could to try to get his life spared. And then finally she went to the governor, and she said, the governor said, "Sir, would you spare my boy?" And it broke the old governor's heart. He felt sorry for this mother. And so he thought, "Well, I'll see if I can't spare his life." And the mother went back home. And the governor there had his pardon all fixed up and there folded up and he put it on the inside of his pocket. He said, I'm going down to the prison, to the death cell. I'll talk to this boy and just see what kind of boy he is. And if he has the right attitude and he's the right kind of fella, I'll go ahead and reduce that death sentence. We won't put him to death. I'll pardon him. But I want to find out what kind of lad he is first. And the governor went down and they set him in the waiting room. And the waiting room brought the boy out. They said to the boy, I said, there's somebody here wants to speak to you. Oh, he said, I guess it's one of them old preachers been coming in here worrying me. And I don't care anything about anything he has to say. I don't believe the Bible. I don't believe in God. And I don't want to be bothered with it. They said he's a dressed up feller. Look like a kind of a dignified political man. And you might ought to come out and speak to him. And so he came on out and sat down with his scowl over his face. And the governor began to talk with him. He didn't know he was talking to the governor. And the governor said, young man, would you try to do right if you were set free, if you didn't have to die? He said, I don't want to hear any of your preaching. I've had enough preaching. These preachers come in here and bothered me and stirred me. I don't believe in God and I don't believe in the Bible. I don't believe in preachers. And I'm not going to promise anybody anything I'll do. I don't have to care about anything you got to say. As far as I'm concerned, you leave right now. I don't want to hear anything you have to say. The governor said, all right, young man, thank you. And the governor walked out. And some of the people came in and said, man, aren't you happy? What about that? He said, what about what? He said, you being pardoned. Me being pardoned. Oh, yes, said that man. Said, he's the governor of this state. He came in here. We've seen the papers. He came here to pardon you. Oh, he said, my Lord, what a fool I've been. There sat in that room a man, the governor of the state, with my pardon in his pocket. And I sat there like a fool and made light and acted like I did. And the man walked away with my pardon still in his pocket. And I must die in the electric chair. Jesus Christ came about 2,000 years ago. He has his pardon. He has your pardon, brother. And he'll give you your pardon. But if you die without God, you go into hell, pay for your sins. But he'll give you that pardon. He'll pardon you from that penalty. Blot out your sins. Write your name in heaven. Save your soul. Now you can do like that boy. You can reject him like he did the governor and go on and die without God. Or you can receive that pardon and be saved. And if you're not saved today, you'll receive that pardon right now. Let God come into your heart. Let's stand to our feet. Our Father, today in the holy name of Jesus, I pray, dear God, that you speak to every heart here. Lord God, I pray that somebody, even the radio listeners, might be saved today. Lord, I pray that you use this message to the glory of God. Have your way, our Father, in the invitation, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Debbie, play our stanza song. Now, while Debbie's playing, listen to me. If you're in this building today and unsaved, backslidden, and you want to join the church, would you come down here while she plays the stanza? So we'll help you if you'll come. Would you do it? You need to get saved. You need to come back to God. You want to join the church. Would you respond?